Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 10765 in the name of Jackson Carlow on behalf of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee on embedding public participation in the work of the Parliament. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. I would advise members that there is some time in hand this afternoon, so plenty of time for lots and lots of interventions. And with that, I call on Jackson Carlow to open the debate on behalf of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's been really some considerable time since I've been invited to lead a debate in what, in my salad days in this Parliament, David McCletchie, then the Chief Whip, used to refer to as the graveyard shift, for which I routinely had a season ticket in those earlier days. So I'm really thrilled and delighted to see so many people here this afternoon to embrace the concept of this report. And I used to, in those days, be unrelentingly jolly as a matter of principle, if only to keep myself awake through till 5 o'clock. So I will be suitably jolly throughout the proceedings this afternoon. I'd like to begin by welcoming to the gallery, actually, some of those who participated in the citizens' panel that we held, who were witnesses to or who advised the committee during the drafting of the report. And I'd really like to thank the clerks, Lynn Tullis and Andrew Milne, who's also up at the back of the chamber, together with Alanis, Miriam and Wojciech, who's just recently left us, who really were fantastically helpful on what I think Martin Whitfield and Richard Leonard rather ungenerously called the committee's world tour, as we sought to establish what the practice of deliberate democracy was in Paris, Belgium and Dublin. So I'm really here to sell to you, I'm here on a mission to sell to you the principle of public participation in our democracy, because I do believe that the implications of the report could lead to quite a profound change in the way that democracy operates in Scotland and in the way that the public, in the widest sense, are able to engage in parliamentary life. And this work began not in this Parliament, although we've been working on this for 18 months since this was added to the responsibility of the Public Petitions Committee, but in the last Parliament, because the suggestion of participative democracy arose in the then presiding officer Ken McIntosh's Commission for Parliamentary Reform, which was adopted by the Parliament at that time. And it was into this Parliament, really because of COVID and other things, that the responsibility to investigate and to take forward the potential work has gone forward. So first of all, I should say what the inquiry has involved. It's involved two initial surveys that gathered views from the public and organisations and academics. We established a citizens' panel, I'll say more about here in the Parliament. We got feedback from the citizens' panel recommendations then from the public, from focus groups, from MSPs and their staff, from conveners. I remember famously the conveners were able to go round the wall deciding which of the recommendations they liked the most and which they didn't like at all. And actually we rejected the one they didn't like at all, which was that a citizens' panel should be set up on an MSP code of conduct. I wonder why they were so enthusiastic about that one. But we worked out in doing that, how has deliberative democracy operated elsewhere? In places that have been quite successful, because we wouldn't be the first parliament to adopt this. We would still be one of the early parliaments to adopt this, but others have adopted it really quite successfully in Ireland, in Paris, and in Brussels. And it's fair to say that as a committee, we went on a journey. I mean, those of you who may have heard my contribution to a recent debate on the whole question about the establishment of commissioners as creating a fresh level of government in Scotland almost by default, will appreciate that some of us on the committee were concerned that were we embedding into our process something that was potentially going to undermine democracy rather than enhance it, for reasons that perhaps it's not immediately apparent to consider, but you know, it's just as legitimate for people not to participate as it is for them to participate. And would greater weight be given to those that did than those that didn't? And might that skewer outcomes for communities? And so we went through a journey, but it's fair to say I think all of the committee became persuaded over the course of our work that it was a good thing for us to do. So first of all, can I say that Various themes emerged from our own citizens' panel. Many of them had never participated in anything before. They were drawn randomly by an external agency to reflect all the different demographics, so not the usual suspects, as we sometimes rather unkindly refer to those who participate in the work of our committees, but those who'd never participated before. And interestingly, for them it was a journey too. Many didn't realise there was a difference between Parliament and government. And I think we very often overestimate the public's understanding of the role of Parliament in our natural democracy. We also wanted to see, as I say, the experience of others in action. And that's why we went to Ireland, where, interestingly, the subjects for citizens' panels are debated within the election manifesto so that they have a legitimacy if the mandate for the government is there. And because Ireland has got so much of its social legislation embedded in its constitution, the process can sometimes end in a referendum. In Paris, government, the city authority there has set up a citizens' panel. They will correct, I think, their practice, because there they brought 100 people into a room and asked them what they wanted to talk about, only to find, of course, that 100 complete strangers weren't very sure, and so they went back to the city authority. The danger of that was that they were then debating an issue for perhaps there wasn't an electoral mandate. And we also went to spoke to the country of Brussels, where they've embedded deliberative democracy into their committee processes. They brought together a committee of about 60, 45 lay people, 15 politicians. They all looked at each other with great suspicion. The 15 thought, well, we are very important people. We've been elected. Why should we listen to you? And the 45 in turn said, well, we know what we're talking about and you don't. And after they'd got over that hurdle, that has actually led to very informed and constructive underpinning of the legislation that is then going through the Parliament. And I think we saw the advantage of that. Yes, I will.
John Mason.
Yeah, thank the member for giving way. I realise I haven't been in the committee, so I haven't been in all the discussions. But I do find this interesting about the relationship between people who are elected and people who are a cross-section or representation but are not elected. And how does he see, or how does the committee see, the balance between these two?
Jackson Carlow.
I think what the committee very much feels is that the citizens' panels, whether they're led by the government or the people's panels, which is what we are recommending from within the Parliament, should be there to serve the debate and consideration of the elected representatives, not to act as a separate imperative for action to take place. And interestingly, what I think came out of our understanding of the people that we had met who had participated in Paris or in Dublin or indeed here, is that the key thing is feedback. People want to have feedback, and they're perfectly prepared to be told that we're not going to do something if it's explained to them why we're not going to do something. And that was very instructive, because the lesson, I think, whether we like it or not, of for many people who've participated in national public consultations or in initiatives like this, is that if they've ever come up with anything awkward, the lead authority has then buried the whole thing rather than have to discuss it. And the cumulative effect of that is a sort of suspicion and a cynicism that there really was any genuine endeavour on the part of the panel to consider what the people who participated in it had actually thought. So feedback is the key, but an understanding that it should be the national parliament that ultimately makes its key decision.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. I'm fascinated by his discourse. I mean, we've obviously had an opportunity to discuss this within the convener's group. From the experience of the world tour, are there particular types of issues that lend themselves to citizens' panels? And in a sense, how do those relate to kind of budgetary issues, where obviously the debates we have in here very often are, that's a great idea, but how are you going to pay for it?
Jackson Carlow.
I mean, I think it's fair to say, for example, in Ireland, the key initial citizens' panel was focused on the issue of the legalisation of abortion in Ireland. And it was fascinating to meet with many of the 100 who had participated, who had gone on quite a journey, because there was a fact-based secretariat that actually underpinned everybody's opinion. And there were no bad opinions, but it underpinned that and led to a significant change in subsequent recommendations. So not necessarily a budgetary consideration in that instance. In Paris, it was about issues relating to the rental sector and to green spaces in the city. In Brussels, different again, because it was underpinning the various committees that were reporting. So what we are recommending in here is, well, we've made recommendations to the government. We've had very constructive discussions with the minister. Of course, there are budgetary concerns. It can cost £1 million to £2 million to host a full citizens panel of maybe 100 people sustained over time. But the report goes on to recommend, what can Parliament do? And Parliament, we think, has a role to take forward in extending deliberative democracy. And we are recommending here, within budgets that already exist, pilots to take place in the balance of this session, one on an issue of post-legislative scrutiny and one on an issue of interest, that a people's panel of about 20 to 30 people could constructively report and then come back to the lead committee with their evidence to take forward. We wouldn't want to involve politicians in that panel. We'd want to have it, again, randomly drawn from the public. But we believe that that will, through those pilots, give this Parliament a real sense of how this can work. And I believe, and I'm convinced, such that we would seek to try and embed that into parliamentary life in the parliaments going forward. There are lots of other issues, but I think I'm out of time, actually.
I can give you some more time, as well. Michelle Thompson.
A comment on the post-legislative scrutiny. I mean, it's something that we're still struggling with within the Parliament, and part of that is for good reasons, because of the complexity and the multiple variables where decisions are made about policies, where you've got reserved and devolved powers and so on. How much deeper did you look at the type of post-legislative scrutiny that might be appropriate for a Citizens' Assembly?
I don't think we went through all the different issues. What I can say is that the PACT team within the Parliament that has been established, and which is really very experienced now and very effective, has an anticipation of the Parliament embracing the principle this afternoon, come forward with two suggestions which went to the conveners group, who have embraced one of those suggestions as being the subject that a pilot on this issue might take forward, which is to do, I haven't got the actual provision in front of me, but a previous climate change legislation where they think a piece of post-legislative scrutiny would be very effective. So I will try and draw things to a conclusion. Now, there are lots of other recommendations within the report that I know are going to be brought out in the summary later on, particularly some relating to the presiding officer's role and responsibilities as well, which we, fools rush in where angels fear to tread. We were slightly more reluctant to be too prescriptive and all of that. But I want really, in my final moments, just to try and, as someone who you can, I think, might imagine is a sceptic potentially of some of these kind of initiatives, endeavours, to say that I think we genuinely saw something that would allow Scotland to evolve its own, because all these different models were quite distinct. So it's not that we are suggesting we embrace one. It's not that we are suggesting a legislative route, because I think what we might want in Scotland could evolve through our own experience. So let's, as a Parliament, embrace the principle of all of this, have pilots, and then work to see what the most effective way of involving people in Scotland in the life of our democracy would be. So many more people than ever before, I think, wish to have that opportunity. And I hope that we can, this afternoon, begin the process of allowing that to happen.
Thank you, Mr. Carlow. And I now call on Minister George Adam. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Jackson Carlow for an excellent speech there. The tone and what we're all trying to achieve here was summed up perfectly by Mr. Carlow there as well. And he doesn't need to sell the idea to me, because I believe he's given all the examples of why it's a good thing for us to go forward. It will be a way of us being able to deal with the many challenges and difficulties and decisions that we have to make, and also at the same time, finding out exactly what the public, the people we serve, what they actually want from us as well, with at the end day, of course, Parliament making the decisions as we go forward. But I'd like to commend the committee and the participation and communities team for the thorough work that they have undertaken to produce this report and its recommendations. It marks an important milestone, as said by Jackson Carlow, for the Scottish Parliament, and it looks at how it will meaningfully and practically involve the public in its work. I commend the approach the committee has taken to this public participation inquiry, and particular as Mr. Carlow took us through his world tour. I obviously have been in the wrong committees, presiding officer, when I was a backbencher, and I've got the wrong job now, because apparently they have tour T-shirts and tour jackets to sell as well as this idea of public participation. But I think all the stuff that came from the committee, I think, were considered balanced and produced a timeline of viable next steps. And I'm pleased to see that the report and its recommendations have also been framed with the longer-term view in mind. The core principles outlined by the committee place transparency, accountability, inclusivity at the centre of their vision for the Parliament's move towards a more participatory system. And that's easy for me to say, Presiding Officer. This is an important step in improving our democratic infrastructure. I welcome the committee's proposal to work towards establishing the use of more citizens' panels and a good practice model and accountability framework for use across the Parliament scrutiny work. Putting in place the standards, values and practices to guarantee high-quality participation is something the Scottish Government is also committed to. The Scottish Government's vision for public participation is that people can be involved in the decisions that affect them, making Scotland a more inclusive, sustainable and successful place. In our response to the IPDD Expert Working Group report, we outlined our intention to deliver this. We have delivered a number of deliberative engagements. Probably the most well-known are our two citizens' assemblies, and we routinely run small-scale participatory engagements. For example, we ran a citizens' jury on the proposed use of QCOVID, a risk protection model for COVID-19 that draws on health data. A citizens' jury works in a similar way to the People's Panel, and this one helped us understand how people in Scotland view the ethics of using models like this. The in-depth process of learning and deliberation that took place for the citizen jury gave us a clear understanding of what the public do and do not find acceptable. This shows how... Yes, no problem.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to George Adam giving way on that point. We heard from Jackson Carlow the challenge that exists between the understanding of the separation between Parliament and government. Do you see a potential flashpoint if the government is participating with citizens' assemblies or juries and the Parliament is doing the same thing as to an understanding in the public regime about what they're answering and how they're trying to help?
Minister.
I take that on board. The government obviously has to engage with the public and to understand what the public are going. But I do understand that there could be some form of confusion, and maybe it's something as we move forward with this model, I'm willing to find a way that we can all work in a way that will make sure that we just get the job done. Rather than us all doing the same thing at the one time. You know, because in these challenging times with budgetary constraints, it's probably a way to think wiser with everything we've got. But this all shows with the citizens' jury how valuable the public considers evidence-based responses when tackling complex issues or taking difficult decisions. As you will know, dealing with complex issues and difficult decisions have always been a part of the work of government and are increasingly featured today. And Jackson Carlow brought up a perfect example of how in Ireland they dealt with the abortion issue and managed to have that discussion here. There's various other issues that are happening in this Parliament at this time that we maybe look at how we deal with that, dealing these using these mechanisms as well. And what will be important to the success of Parliament's work here will be ensuring that those from furthest from government and seldom heard voices are being listened to, and that this work is trauma-informed. And one of the things I always bring up with officials myself is the fact that I don't want to see the usual faces turning up. Those of us that have been councillors in the past will have been involved in many of these types of smaller attempts at these engagement with the public, and you'll be aware that in a lot of cases it was the same people all the time. And for me, it's trying to get people from all walks of life. You know, where is the young man or woman from Fergusley Park? Where is the young man or woman from the East End of Glasgow? You know, where are the people where we can actually make sure we've got everyone from all walks of life and we can actually engage? Yes.
Ruth McGuire.
I thank the Minister for taking an intervention. He described individuals there as being seldom heard. Would he agree that actually sometimes they're easy to ignore? It's not that they're seldom heard, and that we've got a responsibility to make it easy for them to come to us, be that government or parliament.
Minister.
I totally agree what Ruth McGuire said there with regards to we need to find a way to make it easier for them to contact us and to take away. There is always the intimidation of the Parliament itself or MSPs or the elected officials, but we need to make it ourselves as an institution, as a government and as individuals more approachable for the public as well. I note the report outlines barriers to participation. The committee will suggest Parliament considers, and I will strongly encourage this as an area proactively we pursue. Listening to seldom heard voices is fundamental if we want to ensure that decisions we make are fairer and better meet the needs of the people we serve. From the Scottish Government's experience, it's not just about the big policy issues or about how one method of participation versus another. It's about how we, in all of our roles, are considering who is most affected by the policies and the services that we are designing and finding the best way to ensure that their voices are included from the very beginning. This... Yes?
Bob Doris?
Thank you. I'm new to all of this, and I'm really following the debate for the first time in the Chamber, and I'm sticking around for it, and very interesting. Mr Carlo was talking about people's panels, the government's talking about citizens' juries, but lived experience isn't necessarily a cross-representative section of society. By definition, there are a specific cohort who are very easy to ignore. I know on social security and on addiction issues, they are vital that we engage with the lived experience. So where does lived experience fit in with people's panels and citizens' juries? Is that a third layer?
Minister.
I thank Mr Doris for sticking around for this debate, but he is very accurate. He hits the nail right in the head as to why we should be making sure that everything is accessible to everyone, because my officials would tell you I am constantly challenging them to say who is coming, who are we engaging with, who are we talking with, and what is the benefit and how they can help. Because the whole idea is to make sure that these individuals that we're talking about get the empowerment of being involved in the democratic process. And I think this helps with many other discussions that Mr Doris and I have had about people engaging with us in elections and everything else as well, because they see a reason for getting involved in the actual process.
Jackson,
yes. It occurs to me to just maybe suggest to the Minister and maybe helpfully to Mr Doris that although the criteria for drawing people to participate would be random, the basis of that criteria can be determined if, in fact, a specific issue was the one in which there was going to be a particular panel held, where it was felt that that would be fundamentally important to the consideration. And some issues that will be true, in others not necessarily. But although the point is you don't want the politicians to select the individuals who would participate, but for that to be genuinely a random representation. But it can be an informed representation if the issue is so determined.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I agree with that as well, with the fact that we do have to ensure that and some of these issues will be very specific, and they will actually affect a certain cohort, and we need to make sure we do get the best value possible from all the citizen assemblies, or in the government's case, juries, which, just for clarity, are effectively the same thing. The citizens' panels or the citizens' jury, Presiding Officer. But it's also important to ensure that participants' expenses and time are paid so that no one faces financial barriers to get involved. To this end, officials in the Scottish Government are finalising guidance on participant payment. I welcome the committee's view on the methods used for this work should be proportionate to the topic. This is an approach that the Scottish Government are advocating for. I also welcome the principles and aims outlined by the committee, which will enable people to be involved in the work of Parliament. This vision that we all share with the committee. It is important that we all take on the task of supporting a fairer, more successful and innovative democracy. The Scottish Government will seek to support the committee where helpful as it moves forward with its plans. The evidence is there for us to know that this is the path we should be actively following. With this, I look forward to hearing the views of others today as the committee starts to lay the foundations on creating this new, exciting model for democracy in our Parliament.
Thank you, Minister. And I now call Maurice Golden. Mr Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As a relatively new member of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee, I missed out on the world tour. But can I start by thanking all of those who participated in the committee's public participation inquiry, with a particular thanks to the 19 individuals who worked closely together over two weekends and three remote online sessions in October and November of 2022, and thank them for their thoughtful and helpful contributions and the recommendations they made to Parliament. And a number of these recommendations regard the future use of deliberative democracy, for which I commend the panel. any steps this Parliament can take to promote greater public participation and amplify diverse views from communities across all parts of Scotland should be encouraged. The reality is that this Parliament and the MSPs within it hear from a limited cross-section of the population, usually those who are in the wider Holyrood bubble. Those people, interest groups and campaign groups that understand how the system works and how to bear influence on the political process through responding to consultations, media campaigns and engaging directly with MSPs. It doesn't mean that these people shouldn't have a voice, but often it is the views of the few which are seen as representative views of the public. And in many cases, the views of the few may not be the views of the wider public. Furthermore, political parties often seek out those whose views align with their own in order to push their own political agendas as representative of the general public. You don't have to look too far back within this Parliament to find examples of recent bills or parts thereof that have been passed into legislation that are completely out of step with the views of the general public or the interests of a particular community. This Parliament needs to hear from those people. Happy to.
John Mason.
Sorry, he mentions community there, and I just wonder if he agrees with one of the panel's recommendations or comments that community engagement by MSPs doesn't exclude people that are out with community groups, because sometimes who appear to be community leaders do not actually represent the whole of their community.
Maurice Golden.
Yes, absolutely, and it's community in the widest possible sense. I think we've often engaged with community councils, for example, and it's while they do a fantastic job in many cases, it's often the same community leaders that are in many different interactions with elected officials and others. And actually, the point of this is to widen participation beyond leadership at every single level. And I think that has to be the focus, so that Parliament hears from the people we don't normally hear from. And if we can't hear from them, we need to hear from the people that are representative of their views. The process and outcomes from establishing the citizens' panel have warranted the Parliament to take a closer look at the widening use of citizen panels. The committee's recommendation for the Parliament to run two further panels, one on an existing piece of legislation and one on a current topic of interest, should be adopted. And if they are deemed to be of value, then a model for further use should be rolled out for the next parliamentary term. Linked to the previous point about ensuring the Parliament hears from and considers as wide a range of representative views as possible, it is critical to widen community engagement and raise awareness of the Scottish Parliament. In a previous committee visit, I found there was confusion over the role of committees, Parliament and government, and in some cases mistrust. As the Parliament enters its 25th year, this has to change. In response to the recommendations made by the panel in this area, I share the views of the committee that more can and should be done by Parliament to strengthen and widen its engagement with the public, whilst acknowledging the work the Parliament is currently doing in this area and some of the clear steps forward it has taken over the last few years. In terms of highlighting some of the specific recommendations from the panel, I'd like to focus on, firstly, embedding the process of parliamentary democracy in schools. If the curriculum can be strengthened to do this, that would be a positive step. However, this has to be done with a focus on citizens' participation and the role of Parliament, and not an attempt to push certain political views. Mm-hmm. Turning to the... Yes, happy to.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Maurice Golden giving way on that point. Does he feel that the knowledge and experience that our young people had in the first two or three sessions across Scotland and their interaction with the Parliament is perhaps better than the interactions that have happened now. And I'm not just meaning because of the cause of COVID. There are more challenges in travel costs. There are more challenges in overnight costs for our young people even to visit this place, which is raised with me by a lot of schools.
Maurice Golden.
I think we're seeing it. It's far more challenging, particularly for certain schools, of not just having the teachers, but the volunteers that might be required and the costs associated with that. I was almost at school in 1999, so I don't have lived experience of this, Mr. Whitfield, but I think we could look at how we, as a parliament, engage more with our pupils and allow more understanding and better access. But turning to the specific... Oh,
yes. Ruth McGuire.
Thank you. I appreciate Maurice Golden taking an intervention. It was the one area of the report that made me raise my eyebrow a little bit, because I wondered if children had said that they needed more education on the Parliament. Certainly my experience in going out to schools is that actually often they know how things work a lot better than many intelligent adults within my community, because they are looking at democracy in the round and how the Parliament works.
Maurice Golden.
And I think that's a fair challenge, but I also think there's more we can do in terms of allowing access among our young people. And I know separately we're looking at how we work more closely with the Youth Parliament, for example. But again, back to that leadership point that John Mason raised earlier, we need to be cautious about that being representative of all young people's views. But... happy.
Bob Doris.
I thank the member for giving me. I'm certainly getting dragged into this debate now, I feel. I should declare an interest as a former modern studies teacher. Some of the issues in secondary schools is that in some schools, not in my constituency, I hasten to add, if the citizenship is passed to the modern studies department now, if curriculum for excellence means anything, citizenship is a whole school endeavour. It certainly is in primary school. It must also be in secondary schools. Else what we do is we focus that on those young people who self-select and take modern studies. It's a whole school, whole community endeavour.
Maurice Golden.
Certainly, and it's almost the same point that those people that want to be politicians are the first people that we shouldn't allow to become politicians, and that kind of self-selecting is a general thrust of, I think, of this debate. It's about widening it beyond those that are really interested in modern studies. But turning to the specific recommendations made by the panel regarding changes to how Parliament works, and specifically recommendation 13 regarding the answering of questions. I have a lot of sympathy and strongly agree with the frustrations that are posed by ministers failing or refusing to give straight answers to straight questions. Happy to.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. Is the problem not sometimes with the question as well, that it's not a straight question and it's a trap?
Yeah.
Maurice Golden.
There's two sides to every coin, but I can attest that where there is a simple yes or no answer, that often does suffice. And if you look at the official report, you see that I've tried that on numerous occasions unsuccessfully, I might add, in terms of that response. But the panel has suggested on this, giving the Parliament's presiding officer more power to make sure that Scottish Government ministers give adequate answers to questions, although the committee noted that this could make the presiding officer's job more difficult and more political. I believe there should be a way to improve the current situation and agree with the committee that the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee should consider ways in which the presiding officer might be given the power to decide that a question has not adequately been answered.
Jackson Carlow.
It's interesting that in the Irish Parliament, the Com Cymraeg Speaker there has this discretion, and the form of words that is used is for the presiding officer to say to the minister that it's perhaps the case that they've been a little let down by their civil servants in the comprehensive nature of the response they've given, and that they might like to add to the response they've just given a little further. In fact, the existence of that power has meant that it's never had to be used, and I think that's quite interesting. It's not necessarily that a presiding officer would require to intervene, but the knowledge that the presiding officer could intervene has led there to sharper and more focused answers from ministers.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the member for that helpful contribution. In terms of respect, it should be customary practice for members, and particularly ministers, to accept at least one intervention. If not, we should change the term from debate to the reading of speeches, and in due course probably end up replaced by AI at some point. Happy to?
Minister?
Thank the member for taking an intervention. I understand where he's coming from with regards to debate. There is also the drama of Parliament. I, for one, tend to always take interventions. I think I took about half a dozen there. But on the whole, there is also the drama of Parliament itself. As one of your colleagues, Mr Kerry, used to say, it's not a quiet place. It's a place that, obviously, there'll be times when I'll be doing a speech and one of your colleagues will be trying to get in. I will let them in. Maybe not at that point, but we'll let them in later on. So there is also the fact that we've got to actually, as the Parliament and debate is a living, flowing thing that we're involved in. So it's not just a case of you must take one, you must take two. You know, there is the actual flow of the debate itself.
And speaking of the flow of the debate, I appreciate that Mr Gowan has been extremely generous in taking so many interventions, but I would urge that he now focus on bringing his interesting remarks to a close. Thank you.
Noted the power of the presiding officer there. No, I completely agree, and I appreciate there are short debates, and that's why I was suggesting one intervention, because it is incredibly frustrating when ministers in particular, but members more generally, do not offer at least one intervention or take one intervention, not all of them, but because I think that is the purpose of this chamber. So, in concluding, the response of the committee to the recommendations of the panel, citizens' panel in regards to embedding public participation in the work of Parliament are an excellent starting point and need further explored. Yes, there will be constraints and challenges in how Parliament can do, particularly around costs, but as this is an area develops over the months and years to come, we should all engage with it and approach it with an open mind. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Gowan. And I now call Martin Whitfield. Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I think it speaks to the power of Maurice Golding's speech that he had so many interventions, because actually in debate it is about analysing points and opinions that we can show the people of Scotland that we are testing the government, we are testing an idea, and that's the fundamental principle of why this Parliament is here. It is a people's Parliament to hold the Scottish Government to account for the people of Scotland. And can I compliment the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee very much on the publication of this report, and more importantly to those citizens that took part in it. Because I think what we have heard today here is the interesting dichotomy between the desire to participate and the power that the Parliament wants to give citizens to participate. We have cross-party groups here in Parliament. We have the government, as the Minister pointed out, continually seeking the public opinion and views. But what we have here embedded is, I believe, a vehicle that will allow citizens to genuinely participate before the questions, in essence, come for the committees to be decided. And we've heard about the view that we get the usual culprits coming. I think this offers much more than that, because we are considering the process of a random group of our citizens to be brought together to solve questions we can't solve, to remove the politics from some of these questions. And because of the representative nature of it, it's not about them giving the same evidence to a different committee on the same question. It's about genuinely going to them and saying, please help us with this problem because we can't do it. Perhaps we shouldn't do it. And then taking their conclusions and doing what we do very well here through committees and indeed through this chamber to analyse and consider that and say, how can we implement it and how will it work? I have to, unfortunately, with the consent of the Deputy Presiding Officer, take off my party political hat one moment to deal with page 3 of the report, where there are a number of suggestions that are levelled towards the committee that I have the privilege to convene. And I can assure, in one sense, speaking to the members across the lower end of this chamber, but actually more importantly, speaking to those citizens that took part and raised this, we will be considering it at committee, and we will, as Jackson Carlos so rightly pointed out, refer back to you and explain what our decision is and why it is on a number of points. On the second one, with regard to the presiding officer, fascinating to first follow Maurice Golding on that, and indeed the intervention from Jackson Carlow about what happens elsewhere. The presiding officer, the deputy presiding officer, sit where they do because we have chosen them, as the members of this chamber, to not referee our debates, but to facilitate them. And to burden them with an evidential decision on whether or not something has or has not been answered, with the sparklingly light evidence that they will listen in a very well-versed question, or indeed, should I say, maybe a potentially poorly versed answer, I think needs to be considered with a great deal of scepticism, not because of the disappointment that is shared across two-thirds of this House when questions aren't answered, but because I think to alter the view and the role of the person who sits in that chair is dangerous. That, more than, please,
Edward Mountain.
Give way to Edward Mountain.
I thank the member for giving way. I think it's an interesting point and something that I picked up on, but my question is how many times have we seen in this Parliament a minister stand up and answer the question they want to answer, not the one that's been asked? And that's, I think, the crux of it, not necessarily the depth of the answer. But would you not agree it would be useful for the presiding officer to instruct the minister to answer the question they've been asked, which has been through the chamber desk in most cases anyway?
Martin Whitfield.
With consent of the deputy presiding officer, I'm happy to take a second intervention and then try to answer.
Ruth McGuire.
I'm grateful to Martin Whitfield for taking my intervention. I appreciated what you were saying there about the presiding officer intervening on the evidence or lack of that she would have to go on that. I wonder as well if there's a bit about personal responsibility. Each individual member is responsible for their contribution. Asking someone else to come in and referee, to use your term, doesn't really sit right.
Martin Whitfield.
We heard earlier the concept of two sides of the same coin, but what I think we've seen in both of those interventions is perhaps both ends of a rainbow, which is the personal responsibility that every member as an MSP here, and indeed a subsequent additional responsibility as Minister or indeed Cabinet Secretary or indeed First Minister to address the answers that they're given. But also, to answer Edward Mountain's intervention, yes, there is a frustration about it, but it's genuinely a frustration that I think anyone who seeks answers, even sometimes from their own primary school teachers, gets a frustration that the primary school teacher won't answer the question they think they're asking. They're answering a different question. And I do think it is worth highlighting the comment in the report which refers members again to the general conduct expected of MSPs and the fact that members must treat the individuals with courtesy and respect. And one of that group is, of course, MSPs. And it does then raise the interesting element of the responsibility as a member of the Scottish Parliament with the additional responsibilities of being a minister or indeed a cabinet secretary, and who answers those responsibilities when people feel that they have strayed. I'll go no further on that other than to return to reassure those people, those citizens that put this in, that the committee will be looking at it. Putting back my party political hat, and with time where it is, I did want to talk about a definition of deliberate democracy, and I hope that during this debate we can actually identify what we mean by deliberative democracy rather than simple contributions to this Parliament and indeed debates. And I wanted to make reference, following on from a number of interventions, particularly from Bob Doris and Ruth McGuire, about page 6, which deals with the themes that emerged, in particular that it is people from the disadvantaged backgrounds that often don't feel they are engaging with the Scottish Parliament is worthwhile. That's a frightening conclusion to come to, that there are people who are seeking to engage but see no worth in doing it. And I think of so many of the comments, very, very powerful comments that are contained in this report. That one moved me, that someone says, I can't be bothered because nothing will happen. I think that's a poor, poor reflection, and one that we must strive. And indeed, there are views.
Brian Whittle.
Sure.
Very grateful for Martin Whitfield for giving way. But he also say that as part of this report, it's really important that there's an avenue and a route to be able to give evidence to this Parliament or to affect this Parliament that perhaps many of our citizens currently can't see.
Martin Whitfield.
I think that speaks to what I was speaking about earlier, about the concept of the Citizens' Assembly or the jury being asked a specific problem or set a legislative review. There is also a requirement for this Parliament and the committees and the Chamber to reach out, to seek lived experience when it's needed, to seek out the experts and not the usual suspects. And I think that, you know, the current Petitions Committee have to be thanked for the fact that they appear to reach out far more to a wider group throughout petitions and others than perhaps has happened in the past, and we must emulate that. In conclusion, I did want to concentrate a part of my talk on theme six, because along with Ruth Maguire, I'm slightly disappointed in the level of urgency that this has been given. And I think we have rehearsed to some extent where we sit within our schools and the curriculum and the access to this place. But one of the things that flows from this is whether or not consideration that one of the panels should perhaps be a young person's panel made up of a random section that cross-reflects the experiences when we have the appropriate question to ask them. And if a panel was brought together and they were asked, how important is it for young people to take part in the Parliament? I am going to hazard a guess that their response would be incredibly high. It's very important. Please listen to us. So on that point, I conclude. Thank you for your patience, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. And we now move to the open debate, and I call John Mason to be followed by Edward Mountain. Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thanks also to the committee and to the Citizens Panel for their deliberations and input. I have to say I find this a really interesting topic, and in particular how we balance, on the one hand, being a parliamentary democracy with elections and all the complications that that system brings, while on the other hand having and benefiting from panels or groups who might be more, quote, representative in one sense, but who are not elected. I note the panel's recommendations and also note that the committee disagreed with some of them, and I would like to go through the themes and comment on some of these in the same way that the committee did. First theme is institutionalising deliberative democracy, and I note that the committee did not agree with legislating for this, and I would tend to agree with them on that point. However, other recommendations like number 9, building cross-party support for deliberative democracy, which is still to be defined, is absolutely fine, and we can endorse that. Moving on to theme 2, growing community engagement, and in general the comments of both the panel and the committee are good, and we do need to hear from a wide range of people, including experts on a subject and those with lived experience. But of course both of these are often minorities within society, and the wider public may not have strong views on the issue at all. So I think there will be times and subjects when we as politicians need to focus on important issues, even though, and perhaps because, the public is not engaged. On recommendation 5, engagement by MSPs must not exclude people who are out with community groups. And I think this is an important point, as I think we touched on earlier. Not every community group is representative of its community. For example, I am generally a fan of community councils, which are the most grassroots democratically elected organisations that we have, but some are made up entirely of retired people with no one of working age, let alone young people at all. Thirdly, raising awareness of Parliament and recommendation 3 in that regard. And I have to say, I do think good efforts have been made on this, but I accept that that has had mixed success. It is the case, I think, always, that some people are very satisfied when we do a little for them, either individually or as a parliament, while others are very dissatisfied however much we do for them. Recommendation 15 I thought was interesting, and the idea of highlighting Parliament's successes. But I have to say that some people do not want this to happen. They do not want Parliament's successes to be highlighted. They want to run Parliament down and emphasise its weaknesses. And I think the media does have a part to play in this. And it says, one of the phrases from the panel is, we should use media outlets. But I think using media outlets is easier said than done. Both the media and, it seems, many of the public are more focused on the dramatic side of Holyrood, and the same happens at Westminster, with people turning up and watching FMQs, whereas the committee work is often less well attended by the public or featured in the media, but is actually more important. Recommendation 16 on a general information campaign is certainly well-meaning, but I do think this is exactly what a lot of Parliament staff have been working on for a number of years, and again with limited success. Theme 5, bringing Parliament to the people, and recommendation 11, with the idea of moving the whole Parliament round Scotland, it might be impractical, and I think the committee did not support that recommendation. But I would slightly disagree with the committee on the idea of Parliament days linked perhaps to committee visits, as happened in the past. I've taken part in a number of these, and I have to say I felt some were very good. For example, one was in Hoyk, and I think that was mainly while Tricia Marrick was the presiding officer. And from memory, on that occasion in Hoyk, we had a big reception on the Sunday evening and met many, many people across a section of local society. And then on the Monday, the Finance Committee went on to have its meetings while the presiding officer had a separate programme. So I did think that kind of thing can be worthwhile. And so I would... yes, absolutely.
Jason Carlin.
I too participated in some of these Parliament days, but apparently in a lot of the work that was done afterwards to establish what the value of that had been seen to be, it was felt that they had kind of landed, done their thing and gone away again, and that there was no actually lasting benefit, and that the types of engagement that we should be seeking to take from the Parliament out into communities should be ones that are designed to leave something that is going to be more of a legacy in terms of that appreciation of the Parliament itself.
John Neeson?
I think it's possibly both and, because I think sometimes the committees I'm on, and I'm going with the Economy Committee to Aberdeen on a specific issue a week on Monday, but on other occasions, it's just the fact we're there means a lot to the local community. And I remember a visit we had to Isla looking at isolation. And the people there I picked up just really appreciated the fact the committee had taken the effort, which they know about more than we do, to go. I mean, I've been on committee visits to Orkney, Arbroath, Nairn, Isla, Largs twice, Hoyk, Pitlochry, Lochaber and more. But I would have to say as well, I don't think we should just go to attractive rural locations. And I believe that the Greater Glasgow area has not been visited so often by Parliament committees. The cost of travelling to Parliament is certainly a challenge for some, as Martin Whitfield was saying, and I'm keen that schools, both from further away and from less well-off areas, should be able to come. So I do think we need to keep an eye on which schools are visiting and ensure it is not only those that are closer and better off. Theme 7 is strengthening the trust in Parliament, and the idea, which we have touched on already, recommendation 13, that compelling government ministers to give answers to all the questions they're presented with is an intriguing concept. I actually think all oral questions are generally answered, but maybe they're not answered in the way that the opposition or the public would want. However, I do think, again, if the presiding officer was to assess all the answers, I think she should also be assessing all the questions for genuineness, and not allowing questions which are trick or trap questions. So, like the committee, I agree this is probably not feasible. Recommendation 4... yes, OK.
Maurice Golden.
Does the member agree that any changes to Parliament and its structures and the structures of debate need to be done in the round, so not reflective of the current session, but actually reflective of the future of this Parliament and the future political makeup, whatever that may be?
John Mason.
Was that a trick question? I agree we should take a longer term view. I think many of us find that difficult with the election only 2.5 years ahead. But yes, I mean, we should be taking and looking at this. And to give respect to people like Jackson Carlow and Martin Whitfield, I think some members here are very good at taking a longer term view. Recommendation 14. About the idea of the public asking questions in the chamber. And to some extent, we've tried that kind of thing with committees. For example, on the COVID committee and the Finance Committee recently in Largs, we did see questions being brought to the committee, and then the committee follows on by asking these same questions. But it did seem to me sometimes we're asking questions for the sake of it and on issues that we've already actually looked at in depth. Again, I get constituents coming in demanding that I ask a minister... If we've got time, yes.
A brief intervention, yes. Michelle Thompson.
Finance Committee, but if he doesn't mind me saying, perhaps that's missing the point, because perhaps we're too ready to have concluded what the answer is without listening and allowing people to make their voices heard. Would he concede that?
John Mason.
I do concede that, although there's always dangers, there are always two sides to these things. And I think on the COVID committee, for example, we felt that airing certain questions, like challenging the science on vaccines, might not be helpful to anyone. So I think there has to be a bit of freedom. But I accept we're doing slightly different things here between the chamber and the committees, and the committees have more opportunity to engage. As I was going to say, I get constituents coming in demanding that I ask a minister or the First Minister a whole range of questions, ranging from why their bus was late to why their hospital operation has been postponed. And my usual response is to suggest we take such points up with the bus company or the health board as appropriate, and 9 times out of 10 we get a better answer going that way. And I realise that some MSPs do raise individual patients' cases in the chamber, but I question whether that is appropriate if they have not already been to the health board. So overall, I do commend the panel and committee for the work on this. I absolutely agree that we can improve things we do as a parliament, and I'm particularly keen that we get out and about around the country and engage with the general public where they actually live and work. It's clear to me that it has been appreciated when we travel further from Edinburgh. However, I do think we need to keep an eye on the bigger picture, keeping a balance between those who are democratically elected and involving panels or assemblies selected at random. Scotland is a relatively small country and we should be able to keep things simple. We need to be wary of multiplying commissions, panels and other bodies which make the landscape even more complicated. Holyrood and MSPs are much more accessible than Westminster and MPs, and we should aim to build on that strength. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. And I call Edward Mountain to be followed by Ruth McGuire. Mr. Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank the committee for their excellent report. Public participation in this Parliament is absolutely vital. And as you go further away from Edinburgh, where this Parliament sits, you get asked more and more questions. As you go up to the very north of the Highlands, they will know their local MSPs, but they know little about the other MSPs in the Parliament who they feel outnumber their local MSPs, and they feel that, people who do not have their life experience in remote areas know as much as they should do. So Highlanders and Islanders, I think, need this public participation, and they need to be confirmed that it is not a bias towards what happens in the central belt when decisions are made. They also need to know how to engage with the Parliament. As John Mason has made the point, Presiding Officer, a lot of constituents come into your office and ask you lots of questions, but they don't know how to engage with the Parliament, how to engage with the committees. Some of them will know how to write to their MSPs, and we're usually the last port of call in very difficult circumstances, but they don't know how to engage. For example, on the power lines that are coming from north to south, they don't know which committee to get involved with. They don't know how to do that. And we need to rectify that. Now, when it came to the citizens' participation part of this report, I have to admit I was slightly sceptical. And I pored over the report, and I thought it was actually quite interesting for me to see the recommendations of the committee and those people who'd taken part in the panels that the committee had set up. And I became swayed by it. And that's why, putting on my hat very briefly as the convener of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, we're delighted to be able to have bid for, and I think been accepted by the conveners group, to be the first one committee to have a panel to do some post-legislative scrutiny on the Climate Act of 2009. And I think it's really important. And I think it will be an important way for the committee to hear what people think about this crucial subject. Now, taking my hat off then, having made that announcement, which I'm probably getting in trouble for somewhere along the line, Presiding Officer, I do think that it's important that when that panel is formed, and when they do this post-legislative scrutiny, it is made clear to them what their remit is and how far they can actually go with their recommendations. Because there's no point asking them to do something and then giving them a story which they can take part in, but then not allow them to fulfil the role they've got. So I think there's a careful balance. And I'm minded, and I hear what I think Jackson Carlaw said about MSPs taking part in that panel. But sometimes an MSP there just to say there is an issue with what your recommendation would allow that report and the report back from the panel to know how the MSPs can use it. But I think there's a real need when we're setting up those panels, as was made clear in the report, is to get the right balance of people on it and to make sure that they've got the right experience. And as plenty of people said, it's not the same vociferous characters that you meet on the subjects in your constituency when you talk about them. They don't always represent the views of every person in the constituency. And I would like to see those people brought in, the other people brought in. And we need to ensure them, and they need to see the outcomes of the reports that they produce. And I do like the idea that positive action needs to be reported within 9 months, because after that period of time, I fear people will feel nothing's happened. So the earlier we can get back to them once they've produced a report on what they've done, I think is great. Now, turning to the point, and I may differ strangely from Martin Whitfield on this, about the powers to the presiding officer. I am taken by the fact that, as a backbencher, it is very difficult to get an answer in this Parliament. I'm taken by the fact also that Jackson Carlaw has suggested that by having the power but not necessarily using it may be sufficient. But it is frustrating, not just for us, it is frustrating for people who watch the events in this chamber. And how many of us have been told, well, you never got an answer? They talked about something completely different to what you asked them about. And it's unhelpful in my mind because it gives the wrong message about this Parliament. The message this Parliament should be giving is that we're considering every single option and that they're being discounted for good reasons. So I do believe, Presiding Officer, that the Presiding Officers should have more power. And I would just say on that also that the Presiding Officers have made a decision to reduce the length of answers to some questions. That's right, because if you can't get an answer in a minute, you're not going to get an answer in 5 minutes. Yeah. And that means that backbenchers don't get to ask the questions, and people get frustrated that their MSPs that they've elected are not getting the answers. Give way to Mr. Brown.
Can I thank Edward Mountain for taking intervention? Just to say that I completely disagree with him on the point about the presiding officer being the arbiter of answers, and on the idea of treating different classes of MSPs in terms of whether they're obliged to take an intervention or not. I just think that's wrong. On the issues which I'm more supportive of, though, in relation to some of the public participation, there's a concern over a longer period, maybe 40 years, and across all parties, that MSPs or elected members and governments are much less accountable because so much has been hived off to other bodies, you know, commissions or outsourced and so on as well, so the accountability is not there anymore. Does he think that this might possibly, counterintuitively, contribute to that less of accountability? And just on Jackson Carlaw's point, if it's going to cost as much as it is, how does that square with what many of us agree is the proliferation of commissioners within the Parliament? The two things seem to sit at odds with each other.
Edward Mountain.
And thank Mr. Brown for that question. So let's just I'm not suggesting that we have lots more commissioners. I actually think we've got probably enough commissioners. As far as the long-term situation in this Parliament and diluting it, no, I don't. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, the decision whether to incorporate what has been decided at those citizens' panels comes down to the MSPs. And the MSPs have to answer to that panel, and they should answer to that panel, why they are not taking an idea forward or why they are taking an idea forward. And I'm sorry I can't sway you on the presiding officer. I think that, you know, there are definitely different views around the chamber, and I suspect the views may differ from whether you're in government or your party's in government or your party's not in government. But, presiding officer, just moving on, I think that... One of the issues was the code of conduct that was mentioned. I absolutely believe that should run with the current committee at the moment. I believe, having sat on that committee, actually being judged by your peers and answerable to your peers on your behaviour, they are much harsher than perhaps anyone else would be. And I think it's right that we answer to our peers. Some of the other issues I picked up very briefly, if I may, presiding officer, is a public register of interests where the public can say, we are interested in this, and be notified by the Parliament that a subject is coming up. I think it's really, really important, and I think it will help people across Scotland understand and feed into the process. I think the point that John Mason had made... Sorry. The point that John Mason has made about external visits, I absolutely agree. And as the REC committee, as you will know, went out as a committee and held a committee meeting in Orkney and a subsequent meeting, and I think we went down to Gala Shields and did a meeting down there. And I think that's really important because I think that's engaging with people. So the committee can have a prior meeting where people are allowed to contribute and participate in it, and then hold the more formal part of the meeting afterwards. And I think we should do more of that, and it's something that I've not done in this session, but I was pleased to do it in the last one. Finally, Presiding Officer, just mentioning on the education of children as far as how the Parliament works. I think that's really, really important. Now, it is very easy for schools in Edinburgh and Glasgow to pop across here to the Parliament and make use of the excellent facilities that we've got. When it comes to the Highlands, I think that it becomes more difficult. I've certainly struggled to get schools to come down from Skye and from Wick and Caithness just because of the length of travel and the costs of doing it. So they don't understand how the Parliament works. And we have an excellent service here. So I don't know if that service travels out to schools, which might be an option to do it, or whether we make sure it's part of the curriculum. But everyone needs to know. Presiding Officer, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I now call Ruth McGuire to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Ms. McGuire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Democracy isn't just putting a cross in a box every 5 years. The mandate given to political parties once the votes are counted is substantial, but the folk we represent, for them to feel they have trust in our institution and a stake in the decisions that we take, election campaigns and polling days should not be the end of our interactions with citizens on policy. And with all due respect, politicians and civil servants certainly do not have the monopoly on wisdom. And despite some real effort, we can't claim to be an especially diverse bunch reflective of our nation, particularly in terms of class and race. The ideas and policies put in manifestos, as good or bad as they may be, wherever or whoever they're coming from, always need a lot of further work within Parliament. They need input from and dialogue with a wide range of people and organisations to realise their good intentions and improve things for all the citizens that we serve. And no matter how much we might wish it, legislation and guidance that we pass in here are not always in themselves enough to make the changes that we wish to see. We have to understand better how and where the laws we've passed have made a difference or not. Have there been any unintended consequences, or are there gaps that need to be addressed? Public participation in post-legislative scrutiny would be incredibly valuable in this regard. I want to congratulate the Citizens Panel, the Citizens Participation in Public Petitions Committee, the members and the Scottish Parliamentary staff who so ably supported them, for the excellent work that they've done on embedding public participation in the work of the Parliament. And from the outset, let me say that I agree with the committee's recommendation that the Parliament establish two further citizens' panels, or people's panels, in the current parliamentary session. I think it's right that we work towards making the use of such panels regular committee scrutiny from session 7. Onwards. And in commending their work, I'd wish to make special mention of the care and attention that was given to ensuring that the inquiry was accessible and that there were different ways for people to take part. As well as the main online platform, the PAC team and the Parliament's education team provided support and resources to partners and communities to gather a range of views. And I have personal experience of the excellent and creative work that these teams do to ensure voices that we can find easy to ignore or exclude can be central to committee work in areas that affect them. In this instance, that work meant that the committee received additional contributions from people with learning difficulties and autism via two discussions with the Learning Disabilities Assembly, the views of young people in collaboration with Young Scot and the Scottish Youth Parliament, and the views of school pupils in Lochgelly, Gala Shields and Glasgow. In addition, I will take an intervention.
Paul O'Kane.
I'm very
I'm very grateful to Ruth Maguire for taking an intervention. Just on that point, which I think is a really important point about accessibility, would you agree that also our materials that we provide as a Parliament, particularly in terms of education and helping people to understand what we do in this place, have to be accessible, including easy read formats that would be recognised by people who have a learning disability?
Ruth Maguire.
Very much so. I absolutely agree with that. I don't think that anything should be coming out of our Parliament that isn't in those formats. It's not acceptable. In addition, people were able to write or email the committee in the usual way, which provided three additional submissions from Bord na Gaelic, the Scottish Election Study Team and Media Education. Committee members, I'm sure, will talk more to the process. So if I could maybe just share some reflections on the themes. Theme two was growing community engagement. And the committee's report acknowledges that the traditional model of parliamentary scrutiny can tend to prioritise those who already have an understanding of how the parliament works and the resources to engage with its structures. I very much agree with them that this needs addressed. Again, I've witnessed just how beneficial it is to hear from a wider range of people, particularly those directly impacted, in making sure. And when we do that, we make sure that we understand and look at things in the round. Now, I do really value the contributions made to scrutiny by everyone who gives evidence and assists in committee work, and I am not criticising anyone here. But there's undoubtedly a tension sometimes where organisations or individuals giving evidence have been in campaign mode, either for or against the particular law that's being looked at, or maybe they're involved in delivering the changes that the law will bring about and don't wish to seem unhelpful or resistant to the overarching policy aim of the law being examined. I think that widening our scrutiny can only help in our collective understanding of issues and a way through them. I think we can all be inclined to being a bit binary and simple. You're either for us or against us. There's goodies or baddies, you pick your team. But we all know the world's not like that, and the complex issues that we're often seeking to address are not best solved with that approach. Properly engaging with the communities that we serve reminds us of their diversity and richness, of not just characteristics, but also of opinion. And that will help us find a way through any of the challenges that we face. Like Edward Mountain noted, I like the idea of letting people register their interest in particular topics. I think that's really helpful. Most folk do not have time to be responding to individual consultations. I'm looking at the presiding officers telling me to close. I had a lot more to say. It's been a really interesting debate. It's an excellent piece of work. I thank everyone who contributed, particularly the citizens panel themselves. Presiding officer.
Thank you. And I call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Co-Cap Stewart.
Thank you, presiding officer. I'm happy to be here today to talk about public participation and engagement and the public participation inquiry and report undertaken by the Citizen Participation and Public Petition Committee. I'm currently a member of the Citizen Participation Committee. Sadly, I missed the world tour like my my colleague Maurice Golden, and I'm counting on our convener to organise another world tour, hopefully soon. Although I was not in the committee when this inquiry began, I have since worked on the committee through some of the report stages. As many of my colleagues have already addressed, public participation and engagement opportunities must be easily accessible to the public. One of the themes raised in the recommendation, which I would like to talk about today, is regarding growing community engagement with the work of the Scottish Parliament. I've worked in third sector and charity organisation all my life. Through this, I have engaged with many different communities and organisations, and I have been saddened by what I've heard in the past about certain communities' engagement with the Parliament and democracy in general. From some people originating from more disadvantaged background, I hear that they believe politics and participation was not meant for them. From some young people, I hear that they believe their opinion or participation was not wanted. These barriers as the inquiry report recommends, must be removed to encourage everyone to participate in democracy and engage with the parliamentary process. Many of these organizations that I have been involved with are run by or created to black and ethnic minority communities. Over the years, I was disheartened to hear that many from these communities have never thought to engage with public participation within the parliament, and even more, did not even know that it was an option to do so. Many others felt that the public participation process was again not meant for them and did not know how to engage with it, even if it was. Part of this was due to representation, a theme which is highlighted in the inquiry report. As MSPs, we must ensure that citizens are able to see themselves reflected within this parliament. Many also mentioned that they did not feel like they understood politics or the parliamentary process enough to fully engage with it. What is clear is that the current method of engagement with the public do not go far enough, especially when it comes to engaging harder to reach in the communities. The findings and the recommendations of the citizens panel identified the barriers associated with educational level, employment status, a lack of representation in the parliament, and lack of trust in politicians and politics in general. It identified the areas of the community engagement where we are still lacking. It identified that barriers that still exist in Scotland for people accessing and feeling comfortable to access democracy. This includes travel expenses to go to the parliament, time off work, time off from work if they work 9 to 5, childcare cost, and difficulty with accessibility requirements. The proposed citizens panel will help close the gap in parliament engagement. We must ensure that people believe that they have a role to play in parliament, that their voice are heard, and that they understand the means by which they can engage and participate. The purpose mini citizen assemblies will be instrumental in doing this. However, in our role as MSPs, we can work to overcome these barriers that many of public face. We should ensure we are offering public participation opportunities for our constituents outside of normal business working hours, so that those within 9-to-5 jobs or childcare issues have flexibility in their engagement opportunities. We can hold participation opportunities in different locations so that all accessibility requirements can be met. Presiding officer, that is how we can work alongside the recommendations of the inquiry to improve community engagement with the parliament. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call CoCab Stewart to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've just been absolutely fascinated by this debate so far. Anything that considers increased participation of our citizens across the country is of great interest to me. I have had a little bit of the fear of missing out of the world tours and the day trips and everything, but I've taken on the challenge of Maurice Golden to not have a speech and actually just share my reflections and thoughts and some experiences from the committee. So, citizens' participation. I've listened to many people talking about the pros and cons of that and how representative bodies are. And what I've concluded from listening to that is that actually the more variety of methods that we use and the longer that we do that over, the better way we can capture everybody's voices along the way and take them with us in that. That requires bravery from a parliament, because obviously we have our structures. It's taken me 2.5 years to get used to how we do things here. And you get attached to them, they're comfortable. But if they are not working for the public, whom we are here to serve, and one of the things that strikes me when I first came and I went to events was that when the public was there and, you know, people would stand up and they would say, "Welcome to your parliament." And that's a phrase that's actually stayed with me throughout that time. So I support the work of the committee and I welcome this. On the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, we've had a look at doing our pre-budget scrutiny in a slightly different way. We have worked very, very carefully with the participation and communities team, who worked very hard behind the scenes to prepare some of our most vulnerable sort of citizens across a geographical spread as well. Because people don't often have the confidence. You know, they're in their communities, they're battered down by the daily grind of the day, but they have an opinion on their housing, they have an opinion on how that money is being spent in their local authorities, if their bins are being collected or, you know, all of that. But they get frustrated, they don't get the time, they don't have the skills often to be able to feed that back to us so that we can make better decisions. So during our pre-budget scrutiny, what we did was that we allowed time for the team to work with those citizens to build their confidence and to be able to explain a little bit about how to make a valuable contribution, because they wanted to do that. They wanted to make a valuable contribution. The environment is intimidating as well, so there has been some debate about whether people come in or whether we go out, and again, I would advocate a mixture of the two to get a good quality sample. So when they came in, we also did some cross-party work. So my colleague Colette Stevenson, the convener of the Justice Committee, she came and joined that. And the public that came along, the citizens, they thought that was great. Because actually, they don't think in silos when they're thinking about policy. We have portfolios and everyone has their responsibility, but the average person out there, they don't care whose responsibility it is. And actually, as a holistic human being, many portfolio areas are going to have an impact on their life. So they should be able to question it from where they are. So perhaps we need to think about more portfolio and cross-committee working and do scrutiny together across committees to get a true handle on things. So from that, they actually devised their own questions that they wanted us to ask of the minister. So we had the minister coming to committee and we asked verbatim the questions that were actually proposed by the citizens. And they were in the committee room, sitting in the public gallery, so they were right there to hear a response from the minister for the questions. And the feedback from that was absolutely amazing. Some of it, you know, I was surprised about. One reflection was that they didn't understand quite a lot of the answers, because apparently politicians speak a lot using acronyms. And I've been careful not to use PACT. And I have said the, you know, Participation in Communities team. And to be fair, it is like a code, isn't it? It's exclusive. So as politicians, maybe we could be more mindful of showing clarity in when we're trying to speak. So anyway, this person is now going to use the Public Petitions Committee to put a petition to the Parliament to try and get us all to look at that, which is fantastic in that sense. So yeah, I suppose in summary, what I'm trying to say is that on our Equalities Committee, we are leading the way. You always get early adopters for certain things. And I've shared a bit of the experience with you. The citizens have felt really empowered. Their feedback was excellent. They thought that the Parliament as a whole had taken care of them, had listened to them. They felt very connected. They didn't realise that they could see us and speak to us and hear their questions questions being directly put and answered. So we can all take heart that whilst there is work to be done, there is an amazing amount of good practice that's going on. And with this report, there is the goodwill to carry that even further. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call Michelle Thompson, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as members will know, I often refer to academic sources when researching for speeches. Thanks to Carnegie, I now know that, and I quote, "The principles of deliberation and sortition are not new. Rooted in ancient Athenian democracy, they were used throughout various points of history until around 2 to 3 centuries ago. Evoked by the Greek statesman Pericles in 431 BC, the ideas that ordinary citizens, though occupied with the pursuits of industry, are still fair judges of public matters, and that instead of being a stumbling block in a way of action, discussion is an indispensable preliminary to any wise action at all." So this isn't a new idea. I read the report with great interest and extend, like others, my congratulations to the authors, participants, the participation community's team advisors and the committee themselves. I've also said since becoming an MSP that we need to make this place sing with 1,000 different voices, both literally and metaphorically. On that note, and aside, the start-up of the Scottish Parliament Choir next Wednesday, on the 1st of November at 1 p.m. in Committee Room 2, don't miss it, goes some way. But seriously, the extension to the people who really count, our citizens, is extremely important. Let us hear them all sing. I'll make just a few comments that struck me. Firstly, I propose to consider further some of the barriers to participative and deliberative democracy rather than just the recommendations and various themes. Three barriers resonated with me in particular: that of fear, representation, and trust. I believe we all in here consistently undermine the fear of speaking up in public. Despite us claiming, perhaps in a self-congratulatory way, that we're all Jack Tamson's bairns, the fact is, from the outside looking in, we're not. The way we speak, the strange mannerisms and conventions appear inaccessible for many. Many of us here are well-educated, but how often do we stop to consciously consider how our accents sound to ordinary Scots? And I remember just recently being reminded by Darren McGarvey of the great work he's done to drive out understanding of the impact of a working-class Glasgow accent in his series Class Wars. And I spoke only the other day to my colleague Emma Harper about the, frankly, bullying she receives via social media for her sterling efforts to promote our language, Scots. For women, taught subliminally to take their place, often behind and after the men have spoken, it must represent a particular challenge. And I note that even in this debate, only 16% of the attendees are women. The next barrier that struck me was that of representation. And there's considerable complexity in getting together a group, any group that can genuinely be a representative sample of our multicultural, multifaceted, urban and rural, Highland and Lowland Scotland. But perhaps the most important barrier is that of trust, imperative in our politicians, our parliament to make voices peoples be heard, yet lacking at the present time. And there are 21 uses. Yes, of course.
Ruth McGuire.
I thank Michelle Thompson for taking the intervention. She mentioned trust there, which lets me wedge in the bit of my speech that I didn't get to. This whole process can actually build trust in our parliament and in our institutions if we get it right, can't it? If we listen properly and reflect back, as Jackson Carlow said, not always what people want us to do, but the reasons why we're not.
I think it's an excellent point with which I wholesomely agree. I was just mentioning that there's 21 uses of the term trust in the report, and rightly so. We have to acknowledge how many people have lost trust in politicians in the political process and, by extension, their legislators. And sometimes I despair as we go along the hurly-burly of our politics, where people are challenging each other without taking that thought of what is it saying to people outside about trust in their legislature, and I think we need to be very careful about that. We need to maintain it for the trust underpins and is a guardian of democracy. And I would add one group to the list, journalists. And indeed, the report notes getting journalists more engaged to help spread knowledge were both issues raised. Building the knowledge of journalists is valuable. And I still encounter multiple instances where journalists don't appear to understand or perhaps choose not to. Governance, for example, separation of government and the judiciary, and this appears to be an issue with MSPs too, or the likes of the fiscal framework. On another note, I mentioned earlier that I consider this to be a good report. Costs have been carefully considered. We're living in very constrained times, so this is vital. I notice with favour the considerance of governance and accountability, and this model must be maintained. And I completely agree with the other comments about a proliferation of other roles, such as commissioners. Moving on, the report notes that legislation will require government and cross-party commitment. A common framework to measure impact was suggested, and this must evolve over time based on a thorough, committed feedback loop. And the earlier comment from Martin Whitfield expressing disappointment at the proposed timescales, I take a different view. It's clear to me that this must proceed with cross-party buy-in and folding best practice and learning as we go along. Moving to a close, Presiding Officer. Just a couple of comments. I suspect Jackson Carlow's legendary sense of humour contributed to the report, where it notes there can be a tendency for attitudes within a Holyrood bubble to become out of step with the views of ordinary people across the country. I think that that will win this year's understatement. And there's also consideration of a travelling exhibition, and hopefully it won't be our oddest MSPs on display. But seriously, I'm concluding there. Both participative and deliberative democracy and their place in enhancing scrutiny is vital, and enshrining that vital link between citizens, our legislature and democracy. On that note, I embrace the principle wholeheartedly.
Thank you. And we move to winding up speeches, and I call on Paul O'Kane, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to wind up this debate on behalf of Scottish Labour this afternoon. We started with a characteristically funny and wide-ranging contribution from Jackson Carlow as convener of the committee, and indeed I think he commented that this might have been the graveyard shift, but I don't think that is what we saw this afternoon in the debate. I think he spoke about wanting to inject suitable jollity, I think, into proceedings in this place. And I think this afternoon, actually, we've had a bit of that. We've had a bit of serious debate. We've also had some levity, which I think is all too important when we are considering these matters. But seriously, I do want to pay tribute to Jackson Carlow and to the committee for their work on this inquiry and indeed on the report, which I think is very important for us all. And I think people are across the chamber are really keen to engage with it more fully. Also, of course, we should thank all of the committee clerks, the staff, and those who were involved in the public participation elements of the work, who I know are in the gallery today. We on this side of the chamber do welcome the recommendations that seek to improve both the scrutiny of Parliament and government and the engagement and trust of the public in parliamentary processes. We welcome the report's acknowledgement of the fact that Parliament's current methods of engagement with the wider public do not always go far enough, especially when it comes to engaging with harder to reach people in our communities. And I think there is more that should be done to engage with and listen to citizens from across Scotland, and to ensure that we don't put off that work and we seek to do as much as we can in the remaining years of this session, and then look forward into future sessions about how we can really move this work forward in a real fulsome way. I was really taken by many of the international examples that were cited in the committee's work, and I'll declare an interest as a dual citizen, someone who holds Irish citizenship. Although not living on the island of Ireland, I don't expect to be asked to join a citizens panel there anytime soon. And I think it was Maurice Golden who said that politicians are the people who should absolutely be furthest away from that sort of work anyway. And I think there is truth in that, certainly. But, you know, I think it's particularly interesting the work that's been done in Ireland, particularly on issues that I think often have been difficult in the public discourse, issues which have led to wide social change or indeed constitutional change in Ireland, have widely since about 2010 been reflected, debated and decided upon in terms of how to proceed by citizens' assemblies. You know, issues like abortion, like equal marriage, like changes to the voting age or reform of Dáil Éireann in the Irish Parliament, all of those issues have been debated and discussed and proposals then brought forward to the Oireachtas in that regard. Certainly.
Jackson Carlow.
Keane touches on that point. One senior Irish politician paid a backhanded compliment, actually, to the principal of citizens' panels, because he said to me, Jackson, what this is a method for gutless politicians to be excused the difficult decisions and to palm them off to somebody else. But actually, on some of the big social change issues, that's, as I say, actually a backhanded compliment, because it means that the change is underpinned by citizen involvement, which then gives politicians the confidence to move forward.
Paul O'Kane.
I mean, absolutely, I think it could certainly be viewed in that regard and perhaps an easy way out for all of us sitting in this chamber when grappling with some of those issues. But I think it is right that actually we want to underpin these decisions, not just with social attitude surveys or polling, but actually with a structure that can actually say the Parliament has taken time to engage and to listen and to find that. And actually, in Ruth Maguire's contribution, I found that kind of chiming with talking about some of the really perhaps contentious issues very often that we've debated in this place, where there have been competing interests from third sector organisations or lobbyists or various groups in society that often become about we are right, you're wrong, there is no middle ground, there is no concession. Yes, just in a moment, I'll just finish this point. There are no concessions to be made, when actually if we had a better participation restructure, we actually could look at those things in more detail. I'll give way to the Minister.
Minister.
Thank Mr. O'Kane for taking my intervention. Basically, it's important, I agree with much of what he's been saying there, but it's also important, I think, from my experience as the Minister looking at the first two citizen assemblies that we did in the Scottish Parliament, the question we ask is equally important. There's not to be any confusion as to the public as to how they deliberate and come back to that. Does he agree with me that the questions that we ask does give the value that the public will see and has actually been able to deliver something?
Paul O'Kane.
Yeah, I certainly don't think that you know, we should rely on other people. I mean, it's about us saying as a Parliament, this is the direction, this is the vision. It's for the government also to propose their direction and vision and for that to then be scrutinised, if you like, and underpinned, as I said, in response to Jackson Carlaw, not solely for us to be led or instructed by those groups, but to do it hand in hand, so that actually it's a scrutiny of what is already taking place within this chamber. I think we've seen a lot of recommendations discussed this afternoon which have much merit. Interesting exchanges, I think, in terms of how do we bring people closer to this Parliament as well, particularly those from rural communities, as outlined by Edward Mountain, young people, people from ethnic minority backgrounds, as outlined by Faisal Chowdhury, Kocab Stewart and others. Looking at how we ensure that things don't become tokenistic. I think John Mason made some contributions in that regard, that actually questions are meaningful and participation is you know, is about not just saying we're going to ask questions on your behalf, but actually help us to shape our understanding of those questions and the sorts of responses we can have. Interesting contributions on the role of the presiding officer and, of course, the absence of the presiding officer around the judgment of the quality of questions and answers. As someone who often falls foul of verbose and long questions, I might avoid any comment on the quality of my contributions being judged, but I do think that there is merit in having a fuller discussion and debate around that, and I'm glad to hear Martin Whitfield and his contribution speak about how his committee may look at that. Presiding officer, having just made a comment about time, I'm going to wind up. Edwin Morgan, in his poem for the opening of this building, Open the Door, said, "We give you our consent to govern, don't pocket it and ride away." And I think actually that gets to the essence of what we're seeking to do through this report and through this work. It may take time to get there, but I think this debate today and this report and the recommendations are an important first step, and we should all work together to move them forward. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Alexander Stewart. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be winding up for my party on what has been an excellent debate this afternoon. As I say, there has been really good interaction across this chamber, and that is to be very welcome. The Public Participation Inquiry was one of the key pieces of work I was able to contribute to in my time as a member of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee, and I got the opportunity to go on the world tour. This Parliament has long strived to be a place that is welcoming and open to public participation. As such, it was and is to be welcomed that the Citizens' Participation was added to the remit of the committee at the beginning of the current parliamentary session. The Public Partition Inquiry has followed a number of different avenues since the launch early last year. We have heard about some of the engagement work in today's debate. However, the most important aspect of the inquiry has been the citizens' panel on participation. I was pleased that through the panel, the committee was able to deliver not only some hugely positive and productive helpful recommendation, but also an experience which deeply engaged in those who were involved in the process, Presiding Officer. All of those who took part in the panel had positive things to say about the experience, but it was perhaps the panel member, Ronnie Patterson, who put it in his own words when he said, "None of us were well-versed in politics or academia, but we came up with a recommendation 100% as a group." The fact that we came up with those and these recommendations together shows the power of deliberative democracy. Now, that is excellent feedback, Presiding Officer, for a group of individuals who were brought together to represent us and to have their views and opinions expressed. And they got the opportunity to do that. And I think that really showed the success that we had. And while the panel itself was a success, the committee then carried out further engagement to see what we could add to the report. So early this year, as many have indicated, a number of us had the opportunity to go to Dublin and to go to Paris and to see and experience and hear firsthand how they had gone about that. It was 2 years ago this month that Paris City Council voted to establish its own Citizens' Assembly, which was itself formed by drawing on experiences of international practices. This Assembly continues to find its feet and delivers its first recommendations. I'm grateful to the participants and elected officials who provided us and my colleagues with very helpful insights as we went to see these locations in other parts of Europe. And I thank the committee, the clerks, Spice, and everyone who supported us to ensure that that happened, because they had to do a huge amount of work to ensure that the timescale and the information that we had and was beneficial for us all. Now, this afternoon, we've had some excellent contributions, Presiding Officer, and I see, I think it shows the calibre of debates that we can have in this chamber when we have a topic like this where people do have the opportunity to express, interact, and become involved. My fellow member and convener, Jackson Carlow, spoke about the reputation of this Parliament and the perceptions that we had and where it sees and where it goes and feedback and recommendations and the success of the whole process. And I think that there's no doubt that it has been successful. And talking about whether we are enhancing the reputation or undermining that reputation, that was talked about and discussed and has come out there. The public understand, and the public still have a problem when they're talking about what is Parliament and what is government. And as I say, they get confused because, absolutely.
COCAB Stewart.
I understand what you're saying. I'm just
going to ask you. Excuse me, sorry, can I have COCAB Stewart's microphone, please?
Thank you. Thank you. I was just going to ask if my colleague would rephrase that slightly, that it's not the public that has the problem. Maybe it's more incumbent upon us to be providing that education and being more resourceful and creative in the way that we reach out.
Alexander Stewart.
COCAB Stewart for intervention. I think, yes, there is a lesson for us all as to how we here are perceived and represent ourselves, but also how the public perceive us as representatives of them. And there's an imbalance there at the moment, and that needs to be talked about. So I think there's a lot of feedback, Presiding Officer, as to where we are. And I think the pilots that are going to be set forward, once again, will give us an opportunity to evolve and to work together to ensure that we can help one another. The Minister talked about in the report that there were real challenges that we had to deal with going forward, and I think that's the case. And the vision for this Parliament, that it wants to be engaging and that it wants to get the right balance, because the balance is important. Maurice Golden spoke about the themes of the report and how that was, and talked about questions and answers and how that's managed and perceived within this chamber and what is a community. I've not got time to go to everybody, but I'd like to mention the excellent contributions we had from Martin Whitfield, from Ruth Maguire, Edward Mountain, Michelle Thompson, Co-Cab Stewart. They all spoke with passion, Presiding Officer, about what they see within this Parliament and how they want it to be represented. So, Presiding Officer, the healthy level of public participation should be a key ingredient into the way we deal with democracy and our systems. Through the Public Participation Inquiry, we have clearly identified a number of ways we wish to improve the process and participation here in Scotland. It also gives a positive contribution to where we're going. And in conclusion, much work has been done on the inquiry so far, and I look forward to seeing the progress that we will see in the coming years. The report talks about the timescales for 23-24 and a publication report in 25. This report will set out the democracy might become institutionalised within our whole Parliament, and how we can along the challenges across the chamber. I look forward to seeing some of the ideas debated today being put in place at the start of the next parliamentary session. I also look forward to seeing this Parliament take another step towards becoming the inclusive, dynamic and engaging institution that it wants to be and should be. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on George Adam. Up to 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I say I've really enjoyed this very open and thoughtful debate. If only we could maybe do that more often. That's just a joke. But is it? Is it? Because the whole idea is we've all sat here and talked about the challenges and the difficulties. We've done it in a mature manner. We've talked about the way we can go forward. It's maybe something we should all take from this one debate when we actually move on to other things in the future. But I thank all those that engaged with this debate. And one of the common threads of this debate has been not just engagement, but who we engage with. And it really matters who's involved and the type of participation that will work for them. And we must be thoughtful about this when we do this. One of the forms of engagement the Scottish Government does, which I forgot to mention at the beginning, was the Travelling Cabinet. And Travelling Cabinet has started up again, unlike Mr Carlo and his committee, Paris, Dublin, you know, we went to Inverary. It was lovely. But we spoke and engaged with the people of Inverary and Argyll and the specific issues that they had. And that's an important thing for the government to do. And it was good for me to be able to chair that as the Minister for Parliamentary Business, because A, I do enjoy that kind of engagement with the public. And B, it's good that we sometimes feel uncomfortable. It's good that governments get that opportunity for the public to actually get their say. And that specific community got their opportunity to say it. And that's something that's going to... Yes, I will.
Michelle Thompson.
Can you confirm the rumour that the next visit will be to Fergusley Park?
Minister.
No matter how many times the Minister has brought that up, it appears that, as I've been told, we've already been in Renfrewshire one time before, so therefore that's a difficulty. But yes, I will take from this debate, Ms Thompson, that you've obviously encouraged me that might be a way forward for us with... But there's been 51 travelling cabinets since 2008, and it is a mechanism for the public to directly hear from the government themselves. A participatory approach is a golden thread through all the work we do, and this is demonstrated through our Verity House agreement with local government, our social justice work to empower communities, and the review of local governance through our Democracy Matters conversations. It's also clear in the wider work that we do to tackle some of our deepest challenges, such as poverty, inequality, climate emergency, and reforms to health and social care. On the 4th of October, I updated the Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee at their pre-budget scrutiny session to say that the Scottish Government is looking to resource a team that will have the capacity and the authority to develop, maintain and coordinate a consistent approach to public participation across the Scottish Government. Work on this continues, and we recognise that this is not something that one organisation can deliver alone, and this is something that's come up in the debate today because the Parliament has a role in this as well. And I'm pleased to say that this was acknowledged in the committee's report as well. Presiding Officer, we had quite a selection of individuals who were involved in today's debate. Maurice Golden mentioned about parliamentary questions. I was going to say PQs, but we've already been told that we use acronyms far too often in this place, and that's another thing that makes it actually quite difficult for others to engage. I always like to think, Mr Golden, I'm someone that keeps a short, snappy and concise answer to the question. I do engage with anyone who has asked a question, and I think it's important that we take that on board. I have asked colleagues, you know, can you explain the question so we do not have that misunderstanding? Because that can happen a lot of the time.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to George Adam giving way. And doesn't it reflect what Ruth Maguire said, that actually there is a personal responsibility, almost irrespective of what hat you're wearing, to respect this chamber and act appropriately, let me put it that way.
Minister.
Yes, I think so. But part of the reason I do it is I just don't want to be gibbering on for 10 minutes talking about something that's nothing to do with what you actually asked. You know, it's no problem.
Maurice Golden.
I would just like to reflect on how members might gain a better answer. So, for example, earlier this week, I spoke to Angela Constance to give her advance warning of what I was going to discuss, and actually the answer I received was far more full, and it wasn't designed to be make a political point. Clearly there's a part for that to happen, but there is ways in which members can improve their questioning as well.
A valid point, Mr Golden, because I think we have to engage with each other so that we, not just we get the value out of the question session as well, but the public understand what's going on and they get the value as well also. And I think that's a perfect example of all of us taking responsibility in how we do business in here. And Martin Whitfield spoke about the examples mentioned in the report and how this should be embedded within the Parliament. And I think it is important. It should be an important part of these processes of Parliament. Sometimes not all of us get involved in a rammy over a certain issue in this place, but at the end of the day, the public just want this place to do the job, to do our jobs, and they sometimes don't want to see us get involved in an absolute rammy on various issues as well. And I think it's one of the things that we all need to, when we're dealing with highly political and highly difficult debates, we need to possibly look at ourselves in the mirror and say, what are we, anybody else that is not in this bubble, what do they see when we do this? And I think that's an important thing. I, for one, try to not get dragged into that, but sometimes we can't help ourselves. But I think it's an important thing that we have to look at. John Mason mentioned how we balance parliamentary democracy with direct involvement with the public. And that's an interesting point, because to me, that's what this is all about. For the public to actually engage in parliamentary democracy and vote is actually for them to see value in what they believe and what they're saying is actually being talked about in the floor of this chamber. And I think that is exactly what we are looking to do when we do this. I don't know, also John Mason mentioned the parliamentary questions and the presiding officer working out the genuineness of the questions. I don't know how you define that, presiding officer, but that might prove to be quite difficult. Edward Mountain spoke about the importance of us actually delivering on the engagement, and he's 100% correct, because I think this is what I, when I asked my question to Mr O'Kane, was effectively the questions we ask these groups to go and do some work on is equally important. If we ask an all-encompassing kind of long debate, we are going to get a very detailed, good report, but it's going to be very difficult for any of us in here to deliver on what was said in there. When you look at the Irish scenario, they ask their Citizens' Assembly direct questions about certain issues and social issues, and they got the answers from the public there. Presiding Officer, just in closing, because I could see you were motioning to me that I have run out of time. My opening speech I close with, I look forward to listening to colleagues and exciting new models for engagement and for the people we serve. And this can change our Parliament for the better, because the way of working can create a bond, an importance to this place with the public. And I look forward to working with everyone in this chamber to deliver that brave new future for our democracy.
Thank you. And I call on David Torrance to wind up the debate on behalf of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee to 5 o'clock, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I also welcome members of the Citizens Panel to the public gallery and the committee staff, and thank the committee staff for their hard job of keeping us on time and in place on our world tour. This has been an interesting debate, and it's been encouraging to hear from colleagues across the chamber emphasise the importance of making Parliament's proceedings accessible to people from all walks of life, encouraging them to engage in our work. When he opened the debate on behalf of the Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee, the convener says that he'd initially approached this topic with a degree of scepticism, but had ended up as a cautious enthusiast. I think all of us in the committee have been on a similar journey. For me, two particular things stand out. One was watching the progress made by members of our own citizens' panel when they first arrived at Parliament, looking a little overawed and uncertain of what they had let themselves in for, to their confidence and energy by the end of the process. Participants of our citizens' panel worked together for over 32 hours over two weekends and three remote online sessions in October and November. I had the pleasure of participating in one of these online sessions, and it was a day that I remember well. At the outset, you could tell the number of people who initially were nervous, but as the session progressed, you could see them growing in confidence, enjoying engaging with the process and collaborating well as a group. We then invited a number of the panel members to a committee meeting in December last year to outline their recommendations to us, and it was obvious how positive an experience it had been for them. For me, it was extremely encouraging to hear their feedback and positive responses to being involved and hearing more about what each of them took away from experiencing, with comments ranging from, "I've always been a follower of politics, but I did not know the difference between Parliament and government when I started this process. I did not understand separation in the structure." Or, "Some of the information presented to the panel confirmed things that I thought I knew, and other information completely dispelled illusions that I had." The second thing that shifted my own view was a visit to Paris and Dublin to see how deliberate democracy has worked and is working in these places. Neither of these systems, or the one in Brussels, which we also learned about, is perfect, but it was clear from speaking to participants, politicians and officials involved that deliberate democracy has been a valued part of how they do politics. And I'm confident we can find a way to get these benefits here in the Scottish Parliament. Jackson Carlow, Paul Kane and Alexander Stute have all spoken of the Irish Assembly. I believe that from Ireland model, we have a strong example of benefits of a well-structured Citizens' Assembly. The Irish Citizens' Assembly was established in 2006 following the model of its predecessor, the Convention on the Constitution, which ran from 2012 to 2014, and whose recommendations had led to the 2015 marriage equality referendum. For many years, and despite increasing pressures for change, politicians of all colours had been reluctant to engage in the issue of the 8th Amendment directly, to place it firmly on the political and legislative agenda. But it took only the input of 99 ordinary citizens, randomly selected so that to be broadly electorally represented of Irish society in terms of age, gender and social class, to help break years of political deadlock and reach a consensus on this highly polarising issue. The decision to call a referendum was in fact based on the recommendations made by this panel, and I believe it's clear example of how bottom-up citizenship input can complement, enhance representation of democracy and act as an impetus for constitutional reform. We all know the result of this historic referendum held in 2018, but what many people probably don't know is that the outcome of the referendum virtually mirrored the Assembly's vote, with results of 66 and 64% respectively. As the convener says... Yes.
Woolly coffee.
Very much to the deputy convener for taking the intervention. There's been quite a bit of discussion about the online element to all of this, and the digital part of the technology, the part that can play. The member will recall, as I do, that it's only a few years since the Parliament itself embraced at long last the use of digital technology to aid participation, both for members to vote in our proceedings. And it was always possible, Presiding Officer, to do it, but it was only embraced because COVID made it a necessity. I wonder if I could ask the deputy convener, does he see further developments for us to exploit digital technology to aid this process? And did the committee have a view whether we should retain the current advantages that we have using digital technology that are giving us at the moment.
David Torres.
I thank the member for intervention. I would agree with him, yes, and the committee does have views. And if the member would wait, in my speech later on, there are some recommendations about it. We are fortunate in the in-house experience and knowledge and support that has been provided by officials across the Parliament, and I would like to put on record many thanks to all those who have helped us during the course of this inquiry. Turning to some of the comments during the debate on confusion terminology, citizens' panel, citizens' juries and deliberative democracy, these are key terms defined in page 4 of the report, and Parliament should know that we recommend the use of the term people's panel based on our own citizens' panel's recommendation. As well as recommending greater use of people's panels, our report also considers many other aspects of participation. We heard some striking evidence early on about many barriers to engagement there are, and this was amplified by views of our own citizens' panel. As Ruth Maguire's question early on, and Willie Coffey's intervention, the panel made a number of thoughtful recommendations about how Parliament could do more to seek out a range of voices and make it easier for people to engage, for example, by better promoting translation services and the use of an easy read, and by creating a new web page where people can register their details so Parliament can alert them each time there is a new opportunity to express their views. I would echo comments made by my colleague John Mason that getting out and about around the country, engaging with the general public where they actually live and work, is of great benefit, and something that should absolutely be encouraged, because accessibility and opportunity is key to participation. Our report responds in detail to all the recommendations that the panel made, and it was encouraging to find that, in many respects, the panel was pushing an open door. As the Minister mentioned earlier, the Parliament already has a public engagement strategy, and there is already a lot of innovative work underway. We hope that his report and the contribution the citizen panel has made will serve to push that work forward and give it a higher profile. The final section of the report sits under a theme of strengthening trust in Parliament, and that was a bit more challenging for the committee. As Maurice Golden mentioned and others raised in the debate today, we heard earlier on an inquiry that there is a widespread lack of trust in politicians and in the political process, something that many of us also encountered daily in our constituencies and in media. So it wasn't a surprise, but this also came out clearly from the citizens' panel, three recommendations under a heading. One of these recommendations was to give members of the public a direct opportunity to put their questions to government ministers. As a committee, we were unable to support that idea of delivering this through a new type of chamber proceeding for a number of reasons set out in the report, but we do agree the underlying idea might be worth exploring further if there is cross-party support for doing so. That might be something that the Parliament in Bruxelles could look at. The two other panel recommendations on theme of trust were to give the presiding officer more powers to ensure that oral questions in the chamber are properly answered, and to set up a people's panel to discuss MSP's code of conduct. In each case, we had mixed feelings. We understand why public trust is damaged by the way we sometimes conduct ourselves in the chamber, and we therefore respect what has motivated and motivate these recommendations, but also see real difficulties in implementation. For a reason, we have proposed that the Standards Procedure and Public Appointments Committee could explore these issues further.
If you could conclude, please.
This is not meant to sound as if we are just passing the buck. It's more a recognition that matters relating to a member's conduct and matters relating to a chamber procedure fall squarely within the committee's remit and ours. And we look forward to hearing in due course the outcome of the SPPA committee's consideration on these issues. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I'd like to close this afternoon's debate by thanking members for their thoughtful contributions. I hope this has gone some way to convincing other members to support the direction of travel set out in the report. The experience of other countries has shown us that the government is receptive. A citizens' panel can deliver dramatic policy recommendations on difficult and emotive issues through people-led discussion and with complete transparency and fairness. It is now up to us to reflect on the role that we can play in our own democracy, and I would encourage all members to support the convener's motion.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on embedding public participation in the work of the Parliament. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of motion 10958 in the name of Shona Robison on Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill, UK legislation. And I call on Shona Robison to move the motion, Cabinet Secretary.
Formally moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. And there are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 10765 in the name of Jackson Carlaw, on behalf of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee on embedding public participation in the work of the Parliament, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The final question is that motion 10958, in the name of Shona Robison, on Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill, UK legislation, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed, and that concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.